Otherwise, you need to present this talk at this symposium. I have been involved in the experiments on rotating superfluid helium-3 in the low temperature laboratory of Helsinki University of Technology, which is now part of Aalto University, now for more than 15 years. And for most of this time, we have been able to enjoy discussions with Kolya Kapnin. And in fact, in most cases, we received criticism from him, that all our assumptions are incorrect, or interpretation of experiment is incorrect. But then this could, in a number of cases, that resulted in a fruitful collaboration. And this work on superfluid helium-3 would not be possible, of course, without two other people, which you see here on this photo, Matti Krusius, who led the experimental effort for more than 20 years, and Grisha Valei. And, of course, the machine, the apparatus, this rotating nuclear demagnetization cryostat, which you see here behind, in the older version, and you will see also a new upgraded version later. When I joined this Matti Krusius group, the topic was the observation of vortex formation after absorption of the thermal neutron in helium-3. So this absorption overheat the small volume of helium-3 to normal state, and then this volume rapidly cools down. And Grisha suggested that the vortex formation in this process is associated with the Keeble-Zurich mechanism. And Kolya was criticizing this. He said that, okay, this bubble is within the big volume of superfluid, where phase is coherent, and when this bubble will cool down, this phase coherence will propagate inside, and there will be no vortex formation by thermal fluctuations. And actually, this discussion, which eventually led to understanding of the properties of rapidly moving normal superfluid interface and the role of fluctuations there. That's what Grisha mentioned in the introductory talk. Another project, next project with where we collaborated with Kolya was about this dynamic response of anisotropic superfluid helium 3A. In the A phase, the vorticity can exist in the form of more traditional vortex lines or in the forms of vortex sheets. Lines have smaller energy, and so if rotation is started, vorticity is created adiabatically, then vortex lines will form. But what was found that if you change rotation velocity rapidly, then sheets will appear and replace vortex lines. And it turned out that Kapnin force, about which Grisha talked, becomes stronger anisotropic in the presence of the vortex sheets, and that's a key to understanding this phenomenon. But I am not going to talk more about these older topics. So in my talk, I will have two parts discussing more recent work, which continues until now. First one is about how this Kapnin force in the helium-3 B phase, which is rapidly changing with temperature, as Grisha explained, causes actually profound transitions in vortex dynamics, first from laminar to turbulent, and then at even lower temperature to a new regime which we call decoupling. And the second part, as you know, Kolya was an expert in this vortex core bound fermions, and it turned out that this rather interesting object, Bose-Einstein condensate of magnum quasi particles, can be used as a sensitive probe for these vortex core bound fermions and also for the surface bound fermions, which exist in helium-3. Well, I start with a short introduction. So helium-3 is of course Fermi system, so those superfluid for Cooper pairing in state with orbital momentum 1 and spin 1. Several phases exist, and the work which I am going to talk about is looking at the B phase at this low temperature region. But as you see with magnetic field, you can stabilize also A phase and AB interface at these low temperatures, and that is used actually as an instrument, one of the instruments which we use for creating vortices in helium-3. For rotating superfluid, the minimum free energy occurs when the superfluid component mimics the normal component motion, and that occurs through this array of vortex lines usually. And the density of vortex lines is proportional to vortex rotation velocity and inversely proportional to quantum circulation. So the total number of vortices is also proportional to rotation velocity in the equilibrium state. The good thing about these vortices is that the quantized objects at low temperatures, when you can forget about thermal fluctuations, they won't appear out of nothing in your superfluid. And that means that if you are careful, you can create a metastable rotating state without vortices. Without vortices at all, or with fewer vortices than equilibrium state. In this case, they are pushed by this Magnus force into the center of the rotating cylinder. And that means that they resist this counterflow between normal and superfluid component here around the cluster or the container and some excess of free energy, which can lead to some interesting physics. And one particular process which we studied, we inject in controlled manner a vortex into this flow and then see what happens with it. So how we actually see what happens with vortices, as Volodya mentioned, the important thing, very important tool for superfluid helium-3 is a nuclear magnetic resonance that comes from spin orbit interaction in Cooper pairs from dipole energy. And this spin orbit interaction exerts torque in the precession of spin in NMR, and that means frequency shift, which depends on the orbital part on the order parameter, and that means on vortices. And typically in the NMR spectrum of helium-3, which acquires some width now due to this frequency shift, we can find a place so that the intensity of absorption at this place will depend on number of vortices in the sample. And so when you increase the rotation velocity of your sample and vortices are created one by one, say, then you can observe these single vortex steps if your spectrometer is sensitive enough. And of course you need a way to rotate the helium. We do it by rotating the whole cryostat. This cryostat was built originally as within Finnish-Soviet collaboration rota and started to work in 1981. And in the last decade it was upgraded quite a lot. And the goal was to decrease the heat leak to the sample, essentially. So now the heat leak in rotation velocity is below 20 picowatts, and that allows us to work at temperatures about 0.15 of TC, so essentially very close to zero temperature limit. Okay, so let's go to the first part of the talk. Dynamics of superfluid is connected with vortices, and as Grisha explains, the vortex move in superfluid under forces from the superfluid component, this Magnus force, and reaction of the normal component, which has two components. One is along the vortex velocity, that's a dissipative component, and one which is perpendicular to the vortex velocity. And in Fermi superfluid, this perpendicular component contains this Eyardansky and Kempinski force contribution, and this component, which Grisha called the Stokes force, also for Fermi superfluids is calculated by Kapnin, so I will also, it comes from the same physics, and so I will also call it Kapnin force. And if one ignores vortex mass, then the equation of vortex motion is its force balance, sum of forces is zero, and that one can solve for vortex velocity, then you can get mu coefficients, alpha and alpha prime, mutual friction coefficients. And then if you calculate what's the power is actually transmitted to the normal component that's actually dissipated by multiplying VL to FN, you will see that it's proportional to alpha, that's a dissipative coefficient, and that's reactive. And again, as Grisha explained to you, that if you put this force from the normal component for equation of motion of superfluid component, if you ignore temperature effects, that will be just Euler equation, then you will find that there are two terms. One is proportional to alpha, which is dissipative, and another inertial. And then you can apply the same logic as you applied to Navier-Stokes equation to introduce some characteristic number as a ratio of the, this inertial and dissipative term, and that turns out to be this combination of the mutual friction parameters. That was actually introduced by Grisha in 2003. We call it kind of some analog of Reynolds number, so Rea alpha, because of this alpha. And if one goes to Fermi superfluid, then this force comes from this vortex core bound fermions, this anomalous branch, and of course the Eyardansky force. And if one actually calculates this expression for the alpha, that simplifies a lot. It just will be a product of the mean gap times the relaxation time, and that's a Kapnin number. Grisha introduced. Nice feature of this number is that the mini gap goes to zero when temperature goes to TC, so it goes to zero at TC, and when you go to the zero temperature, then in the simplest case the relaxation time diverges, so that goes to infinity, and that means that there will be somewhere a region in your temperature range where it's about unity. And again, in analogous to classical hydrodynamics, you can think that maybe this is the region where there will be transition from laminar to turbulent dynamics. But now you see that this characteristic number, which determines this ratio of inertial and dissipation effects, does depend on velocity, unlike in classical hydrodynamics. Okay, so how do we observe this transition in vortex dynamics? We have a long rotating sample, which is carefully prepared so that you can rotate it without spurious vortex nucleation. And then one introduces into this metastable vortex-free state where there exists this applied flow vortices. There are a few ways to introduce it. Then the best one is actually instability of the AB interface in rotation. The A phase we create with this additional magnetic field, which inject a bundle of around 10-20 vortices into the bulk helium 3. Then there is this neutron absorption, which exerts this few vortices. And one can also make somehow pre-existing vortices. So one creates vortices with some technique, then you stop the rotation, vortices start to annihilate. You capture them in the state, then vortex end on the sidewall, increase rotation velocity again rapidly, and then you have trapped vortex into this flow around the vortex cluster. And then we see with these NMR spectrometers what happens to these vortices. If actually nothing happens, there is no turbulent instability, then their number is conserved, they just increase slowly along this column and goes to the center of the sample. And as I say, we look at the NMR spectrum, for example, at this place where the more vortices, the bigger absorption. And then we see that the NMR signal doesn't change much after vortex injection. On the other hand, if dynamics becomes turbulent, so first vortex becomes unstable, it reconnects, self-reconnects, produces more vortices, and that eventually results in some avalanche, which we call turbulent burst, which produces a lot of vortices, so almost equilibrium number of vortices, and then they start somewhere locally here, close to injection site, and then they start to expand along the column to lower the free energy, and when they come to NMR spectrometer, then suddenly the signal changes a lot in NMR absorption. And this is an example of the measurements. So some injection with this AB interface where this absorption changes a little bit. So that means that the vortices we injected didn't multiply, and the one where it changes a lot, so which signifies its turbulent multiplication. And then one can do it as a function of temperature and rotation velocity, and this is this area alpha. And one can see that, so blue points are these points, red points are these points, turbulent, and then you see really the transition from laminar to turbulent dynamics, which is approximately velocity independent, but controlled by temperature. And one can repeat it with different injection methods. And if actually side wall of the sample is involved in multiplication, then this transition becomes slightly velocity dependent. But in any case, for different injection methods, here you see neutrons, here these remnant vortices. This transition is rather sharp and happens close to real alpha, close to unity, which is quite, of course, different from the case of classical liquids where Reynolds number is typically large, 100 to 1000 transition. So that was experimental fact. Actually, we observed it before. The explanation from Grisha, for example, came about these two terms in vortex equation. But Kolya Kapnin was not happy with this explanation. So he suggested his own model for this transition, from laminar to turbulent dynamics, which is account more for experimental details, that we have some region where we injected vortices, where they become unstable, and so they multiply, and then the applied flow extract them to the region where they kind of stabilizes by rotation, and they observed, and they don't multiply them anymore. And then he applied some logic, which was also kind of used by Joe Wining for deriving his equation for turbulent vortex dynamics some time ago, and derived his equation for vortex density, which contains the terms which gross vortex density to reconnection and this extraction term. But then he found that indeed this increase of vortex density will win if this real alpha is larger than about unity. So, different explanation for the same experimental transition. And what he also pointed out, what is important, that all this logic is applicable only if you think that normal component is stationary and it is not involved in the dynamics. And you can actually see how much mutual force is acting on the back of the normal component and derive criteria where the normal component can be considered is not stationary. And that was what he derived, and then it happens that viscosity of the normal component should basically exceed much the quantum of circulation. And that's very well satisfied in helium 3, while in helium 4 the situation is quite different. Okay, so now one can actually look at this turbulent state which occurs at these low temperatures. And first thing which one realizes with this turbulent state that your superfluid become not ideal fluid even in the zero temperature limit when the normal component is epsilon. And the reason is similar that to this viscous anomaly in classical turbulence, where the dissipation does depend on actually on the viscosity of the liquid, but only at the flow at the global scale. And the only thing which depends on viscosity is to the smallest scale to which turbulent cascade extends. So here, this mutual friction dissipation as we go to what zero temperature is decreasing, but the turbulent cascade will extend to lower and smaller scales, and the total dissipation will not vanish. And actually, about a decade ago, maybe 7 years ago, that was a big question to observe this final dissipation in superfluids in the zero temperature limit, and it has been observed actually in a number of processes. And here, one example of our measurement. That's this expanding vortex front after the turbulent burst, when this vortex is expanded into this metastable vortex-free state. And of course, they dissipate this free energy difference between the states. So by observing this velocity, you essentially look for the dissipation. And then you can see that if it will be laminar motion, then this velocity divided by omega r, this dimensionless thing, will be just about alpha. This mutual friction parameter, but in reality much larger, like 2 or 3 orders of magnitude larger here at low temperatures. So with dissipation it's clear, so this turbulence is actually makes superfluid not ideal. But what about the drag coupling to the wall? So if because the role of normal component in this experiments is actually twofold. First, it provides dissipation, but the second, it provides coupling of superfluid component to the rotating sample, assuming that the walls are very smooth and there is no beam. So what about this drag? Does the turbulence will introduce also something non-trivial there, like some effective boundary layer? In principle, you can think about some strange thing that close to the boundaries there will be emission of some small vortex loops, only preferably in one direction. And when they go and collide with the wall, that transfers momentum and that results in drag. But of course, the question is something like that happens for this momentum transfer, which is affected by turbulence. And so that's not easy to measure, because that you have to really avoid all these pinning and friction effects. But it seems that we were able to solve this problem. And so we were actually able also to measure this coupling for here for angular momentum transfer to the sum tube. And for that we actually studied with rotation of vortices here using nuclear magnetic resonance, and also measured directly the heat released in this process, this tiny heat which is released when vortices move along this tube. So this heat is on picowatt level, so it was quite some hard work. And of course you need to have a sensitive bolometer, and the sensitive bolometer in this case that you have some thermal impedance, which is this very small hole, and the sensitive thermometer, which is here a quartz tuning fork, like from your watch, oscillating inside superfluid and feeling the density of the thermal quasi-particles. And it turns out that we were able to reach this 0.1 picowatt sensitivity with this kind of bolometer, which originally came from Lancaster in the United Kingdom, the ideal. And that's what we saw. So originally we expected that we triggered this front motion with this AB instability. Vortices expand, you will get some constant dissipation. They arrived here, and then this dissipation goes away. But that what we observe is completely different thing, like this triangle shape, and this additional bump here, which is actually characteristic of the laminar, not turbulent dissipation process.
It is bump?
Well, it's you can't see here very much, but this shoulder. That's what doesn't go like here, but here. So, well, you can fit this dissipation with some model that actually turbulent front, behind the turbulent front, the superfluid does rotate at the container angular velocity, but here only at about 0.4 of a container angular velocity. And only after the front has disappeared, so then there is this slow laminar formation through the residual normal component. Because this time scale here is determined by alpha. Okay, and I unfortunately don't have time to go into detail about this explanation, only about the idea. So, when you consider this thing in the beginning about this average equation of vortex hydrodynamics and this ratio of lamin of viscous and inertial torque, we put there the same alpha which we derived for the single vortex. But that can be done only if locally in your motion all vortices are aligned in the same direction and parallel. Now you have a turbulent motion, so vortices are doing something else. So to account for that, you need to introduce some effective friction, which is not the single vortex friction. Now, if you talk about this effective friction, then it's not a universal quantity, it becomes a process dependent. Think about, for example, quasi-particle scattering time, which you introduce, say, in helium-3 to calculate the viscosity or heat conductivity or something else. Then for all these processes, this time will be actually different, because it's some effective quantity. And so the idea here is that let's introduce this effective alpha, but separately for the energy-related processes, and another alpha, effective alpha, for this momentum exchange-related processes. For example, vortex front propagation, it dissipates this free energy of this metastable vortex free rotation, so let's introduce, that would be alpha for the energy. But this coupling to the container, this spin-up from the container motion for the normal component, that's a coupling through this angular momentum. And then you can actually get rather simple model, which introduces one more important quantity into the problem. This exchange of the angular momentum is also very much depends on vortex tension. Because when vortices expand, they also rotate like that and they become twisted. And these twisted vortices, due to this vortex tension, they also result in the angular momentum transfer. And so this actually introduces a quantity, a characteristic quantity into the vortex dynamics, which looks almost like Reynolds number in classical dynamics, velocity times special scale divided, but here instead of viscosity you get the quantity which has the same dimension, which is quantum circulation. And then what basically here, that if you have high temperatures, so that this alpha is smaller than this quantity, then your coupling effects from the normal component is strong enough so that the superfluid fills the container very well. If you go to lower temperatures, then internal dynamics of superfluid component coming from, say, from board extension is more important than the coupling effect and to the container wall. And then you get a kind of crossover to a different regime. And then from the simple model you can get this characteristic features here, for example, the front velocity at this high temperature should be proportional to the rotation velocity of the cryostat, like in the laminar motion, but at low temperatures you get the square dependence. And that's actually, it is observed in experiment. And also this strange shape of the rotation front velocity as a function of temperature with the faster change here than here over here is also get explained within a simple model. But what is interesting that one can look at these effective values which one get. So one can think that they consist of two parts. One which comes from the normal component, so it's proportional to alpha, of course, but probably renormalized with a quantity of about of unity due to that vortices are not straight and things like that. And additional part, which comes from turbulence or maybe from wall friction and things like that. And now, if you fit this to the data, then you see that for the energy, you really get, as expected, as was known from previous experiment, big contribution for this turbulent energy cascade. So, 0.2 is actually friction from normal component at about this temperature. So, it's really big effect. But if you look at the angular momentum transfer, then this residual contribution is actually very small. So, and it probably can come from this residual friction from the walls or things like that. So, the actually answer. And here there are these parameters of effective friction measured using this direct measurement of energy dissipation and front rotation. We can measure them also directly, not only through this fit to velocity data, which are this line, but you see they agree. And then you see really this two orders of magnitude difference at this low temperatures and rather small difference between this one and single vortex alpha. And so one can remember this old D'Alembert paradox, which is concluded that in this ideal fluid, the body moving through liquid will experience no drag and no dissipation, and which is resolved in classical liquid through boundary layers. But here we have a very strange dual situation. So in superfluids at very low temperatures, due to the turbulence, dissipation is not zero, but the drag is essentially is very small, so no effective boundary layers are formed due to turbulence. And this is kind of a phase diagram of the states. So one can say that turbulence is a two-component fluid, so you will need two effective numbers. To one is this number A alpha, which is in Fermi superfluids, is Kapnin number, and it depends on temperature. Another depends on velocity. And then you get this transition from laminar to turbulent dynamics, and then to this strange regime decoupled at the low temperatures. And Grisha showed a similar diagram there, but he was talking in his talk, he was talking about different states of turbulent motion. The transition is somewhere here. And that actually has never been, have up to now, was not observed either in simulations or in experiments, this transition which he predicted. But this one, it seems that it has been observed even before it has been realized in the this front measurement. This is some other measurement in Helium 4 and some calculation of vortex dynamics. And then you really see some anomalies happening when these two quantities are about the same. Okay? See? Yes. So, that was about the turbulence. So, interesting question about what happens with the pure single old mutual friction in the limit of very low temperatures. Unfortunately, I have to skip much of that, except that I can say that from these Manchester measurements, so Kapinski predicts this exponential decrease to zero. From the Manchester measurements which Grisha showed to you, there was some discussions, is this equation completely correct or not? And our measurements towards much lower temperatures here shows that this Kapnin, as usual, has been perfectly right. But his theory is actually for the vortex, which is perfectly straight, move with constant velocity in the infinite path of superfluid. And all this is violated at this low temperature dynamics due to turbulence. First, the mean free path becomes larger than the sample size of the quasi-particles. The vortices are in an accelerated motion due to this turbulence, reconnection, Hilbert wave. So what happens then with mutual friction? And that's a question which we discussed quite a lot with Kolya, and he said that it would be nice to do something. Unfortunately, he had no time to study this question, but luckily Mikhail Silaev was able to develop some model which is really shows that at very low temperatures, due to interaction of Kelvin waves with these core-bound fermions, you get the mutual friction which depends on acceleration of vortices, which can become finite in the zero temperature limit. And there are some preliminary measurements which show this finite alpha, but it's not yet clear is it connected to this mechanism or not. Okay, so now I quickly switch to this second part of the talk. So
15 minutes.
Yeah. So recently it's become rather popular topic, this Bose-Einstein condensation of quasi-particles. This exciton polariton condensates, for example, were mentioned by Volodin and Ian. So what one need to observe this Bose-Einstein condensation of quasi-particles? So basically, one needs that they behave almost like a particles. So you should have a finite system where the thermalization time of these quasi-particles to the sample, to the total system, is long, while the thermalization within the subsystem of quasi-particles is reasonably short. Then you can pump non-equilibrium quasi-particles to the system and do something with them while they are still living. And so, in a sense, this Bose-Einstein condensate of cold atoms is also observed in metastable system, because we know that for these alkali metals, the equilibrium state is solid, and so they have this in metastable Gaussian state and with the loss of atoms. And in helium-3, this is a nice Bose quasi-particles is magnons, spin relaxation time is long in helium-3. And so you can really pump this long-living non-equilibrium quasi-particles and see what happens with them. And so basically magnons is quantization of spin waves. They have this spin minus h. And if you have a coherent state of these quasi-particles, that's described by wave function, where this tipping angle is an amplitude, and the phase of precession is the phase of the wave function. And if you have phase coherence, then you have a coherently precessing magnetization. And despite that there is different magnetic field and different spin orbit energy in different parts of the sample. And we are looking at the trapped condensates, so we have a trap for our magnons. And one part of the trap, since they have this minus H, they are low field seekers, so we have a minimum of the magnetic field in the axial direction, while in the radial direction, this actually spin orbit interaction energy from this equilibrium texture of orbital texture of helium sample provide this radial trap. And it turns out that these traps are almost harmonic, so rather close analogy with cold atoms. And this trap is nicely isolated from the walls. As probably you know, this magnetic relaxation is usually associated with the walls. So if you have this thing isolated from the walls, it can be really long-lived. And so manifestation of coherence of the condensate is the fact that you pump some arbitrary non-equilibrium magnons, you at some non-resonant frequency, even with the noise. And then spontaneous coherence appears, spontaneous precession at the ground state of this trap. And so if you do a Fourier transform from this pickup signal from the NMR coils, you see a sharp peak corresponding to this frequency of precession, and then you see here this condensate is decaying, amplitude is decreasing, here it's leaving for about 200 seconds at precession frequency of 1 MHz. You will see that this also precession frequency is changing. That's one thing to be pure about these condensates, that you don't see it for atomic condensates, because they can modify their own trap through the spin orbit interaction, they can modify orbital texture, but I'm not going to talk about that. But what I'm interested in here is this really long relaxation as a sensitive probe of relaxation sources. So what we want to do, we want to take this condensate, we want to put it with contact with vortex cores, or we want to put it with the contact with the free surface of helium. So let's first look at this situation with vortices. First we do the measurement in the stationary sample without vortices. We see magnetization has nice exponential dependence from which you can extract relaxation rate. And actually the only thing you can observe for this condensate isolated from the wall is a function of temperature, just relaxation through the normal component. So this fork thermometer width of the resonance is actually measures then this density of normal component, and then you see that this relaxation is just proportional to that. Now when we rotate the sample, we observe similar dependence. Now the slope of this changes because actually vortices affect the texture and also the trap. And so the trap changes, and so the interaction with normal component changes. But what you see here now in the zero temperature limit, it's extrapolated to some finite value that these vortex cords produce some extra relaxation. Or vortices, we don't know yet if it's vortex cores. And then what you measure this relaxation is a function of rotation velocity. And pressure changes the core size. And then you see that there is this expected dependence on rotation velocity for the number of vortices and rapid dependence on pressure. So where this relaxation comes from? And actually it was suggested by Polyakhanin and Grishin that this relaxation, it actually was here. In the previous part, the experiment was before theory. Here, the actual theory was before the experiment, and only now we get the tool to actually measure this thing. So, the idea is the following. So, vortices in the B phase, they are, at low temperatures, are special. They have non-symmetric cores. So, the cores are not round, like here. And that means they have extra degree of freedom, like twisting. So, and this transition from symmetric to non-symmetric cores is actually is seen in the experiment, for example, through the effect on the texture. Now, if we consider this twisting motion of the vortices, that will interact with these core-bound fermions, and will excite these core-bound fermions and then result in friction. And how you can put these cores into motion? Actually, when this magnetic moment of the sample is precesses in the NMR, it's interact with the anisotropic order parameter in this core, and that puts some extra torque on this vortex, which drives it into the motion. And there is some another contribution which actually pins the vortex to the equilibrium orientation of the texture. So you have this driving pinning torque and also friction from the core-bound fermions. And this equation, depending on all these three parameters, are actually can have different kinds of solutions. But in this our regime, which we have studied, this vortex is doing only small oscillations around this position determined by the spinning torque. And in this case, this dissipated power will be proportional to this friction coefficient. And in fact, so by measuring this dissipation and by measuring these quantities, that you can extract information on the other parameter in the core, and this friction, you get information from the core-bound fermions. And just quickly say that one can see this, I'm not going to go through these formulas. So some expected magnetic field and pressure dependence of these parameters. And then you see that the qualitative dependence are agrees with experiment well, particularly this rapid pressure dependence, which is the delta squared essentially, is observed. But also the absolute value agrees nicely with Kapnin theory. To actually calculate, compare absolute values, one have to take into account that Magnum condensate is actually is covering only few vortices. So you have to take this into account. But anyway, so the from comparison you see that this is the measured value and this is calculated for this particular pressure. But of course the interesting feature which is we would like to observe and what was predicted by Kapnin and Valery that the frequency dependence of this absorption. So if one look at the spectra of these vortices into of these vortex core bound fermions, then the prediction is that there will be resonance absorption when this frequency is integer value of the minigap. Of course, biggest if this frequency is just equal to minigap. To observe these transitions, of course, you need to have the width of the levels much smaller than the minigap. So we again go to this Kapnin number, which is indeed, as you know, at low temperatures you can easily get these conditions. Okay, it's just the experiment which is running now, and that's kind of measurement which we have been able to achieve now. For now, we so far can't extend this to very low frequencies, so we hope to have this multiple transition over multiple states, but so far, as you see, nothing is observed here, for example, a transition of around 5 of minigaps. But we will work further on increasing this to this low frequencies and also going to higher pressures since the mini gap will increase with pressure. And another thing, since helium 3 is topological superfluid, there are also Majorana bound states at the surfaces of the of this superfluid. And and so we are also interested to observe those using the same technique. So if you have a free surface of helium 3, then there is a natural trap for magnets from the orbital texture. And using this minimum of magnetic field, you can kind of pull off the condensate to the bulk. So one can, in the same step, compare relaxation in this configuration and this configuration. And then for the bulk you observe the thing which I showed to you, and for the surface you really observe rather big relaxation in zero temperature limit. The smoke gun for this coming from this Majorana fermions would be this anisotropy of this relaxation as a function of magnetic field direction, but this anisotropy only will be seen only at the magnetic fields, which we are still not able to do the measurements. So it's much smaller magnetic fields. So that's again one things we want to do in the future. Okay, so I'm coming to the summary. So Kapnin force dominates the friction in the Fermi superfluids and it's rapidly decreasing with the temperature, and that causes profound transitions in vortex dynamics to from laminar to turbulent regime and then to decoupled regime. Strange regime with so much different mutual friction values for energy and momentum. So what all consequences would be for dynamics, we don't know. It has not been really considered. And another thing is this magnet BC is a sensitive tool to measure magnetic relaxation. And actually, this omega tau becomes so small at the ultra-low temperature helium 3 that one should be able to resolve transitions not only between this... not only between these big minigap values, but for each angular momentum, the minigap is in principle a little bit different. And so transition between these levels and these levels should result in separate absorption peaks. And in reality, at very low temperature, you might be able to observe this frequency comb even. Should be possible to observe. And another one is to prove this Majorana nature of surface bound fermions via anisotropic relaxation at the low magnetic fields. And of course, I have to thank collaborators over all these years, of course, Коля Капнин, Мати Крусис, Гриша Воловик, and we have postdocs and a number of students and visitors working on this project. Thank you.
So, questions, remarks, comments?
Yeah. Speaking of your talk, you showed the comparison of model calculation green curve with noisy experimental curve.
Yes.
Red one.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah. Do you see this oscillation in the tail? And there is no oscillation theoretical curve. Is it noise or some physics?
Yeah, it's experimental problem. Think about that you have a machine which is weighing what about 700 kilos, rotating at this rotation or rotation in 2 seconds, and you want to measure the dissipation on the level of 0.1 picowatt. So that's just variation of the background heat leak.
Okay, so could you return to the phase diagram?
This characteristic time.
This one. What does it mean, the curve of tritium?
Yeah, so that we don't know actually quite. We see the consequences, like the superfluid stop to feel the feels less and less the rotation of the sample walls. Which is kind of natural.
Yes. Decouples from walls.
Yes, decouples from walls. Walls.
Okay.
Yes, but simultaneously it has a rather big internal dissipation. So that's a new regime kind of motion. Yeah, but decoupling from the walls. Stop feeling this reference frame.
Quite natural. Okay, so let us thank the speaker again. Okay, Dima. On the blackboard?